Sure.
I was reading it. So she dedicates her books to her daughter always, which is cool, but...
Well, not always, but...
Well, yeah, but she says, to Mackenzie, my beautiful daughter, I dedicate her ink and paper to mine. What does she mean by that? Who did she...
Who?
Write?
Well, yeah. Notice, and this is Mackenzie, this is her second daughter.
Right.
Her first daughter is Jessica.
Right.
Okay. I'm not sure. I think it might be Hermione.
Okay, that's what I thought too, but I never looked into it. I just was wondering.
Because she has said in interviews, she bases Hermione on herself. She kind of was Hermione. In fact, she said in those, and she says in several interviews, most of the characters are based on real people.
Yeah.
Okay. You can actually see a picture in, if you've purchased, and if you haven't, you really ought to. If you've purchased the new illustrated Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone or Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, you know, which is this tall by that thick by about that wide, okay? They just came out with images for Chamber of Secrets, which will be out in October. The guy includes, no, it wasn't in there. Was it in there? I was going to say the guy includes in there, but it wasn't. It was in a news article, or maybe on Pottermore, where he included images of people that he used to draw his ideas. Rowling has said she came up with Hagrid because of a biker that she saw somewhere in the Midwest. Midlands of England or Yorkshire, okay? And the guy who drew it has a photograph of this big, massive, burly biker with hair just everywhere and his big old massive beard and said, that's Hagrid. Whether he knows it or not, that's Hagrid. Okay. So, the other minister. Notice how this one begins. Or notice where it doesn't begin. It doesn't begin in number 4, Privet Drive. So she's breaking kind of the mold again. And just as she does in Goblet of Fire, when she breaks that formula and breaks that mold, this book is rather different than the others. Okay? Because we're going to kind of jump right into seeing what? The kind of world that is described in Goblet of Fire. Imagine for a moment that Lord Voldemort is back, Sirius tells Harry, Ron, and Hermione. Okay? People are dying, they're disappearing, this is happening, that is happening. Okay? So, the other minister. Who's the other minister? The British Prime Minister. Okay? And notice what happens. Very first page. Second paragraph. The Prime Minister's pulse quickened at the very thought of these accusations, for they were neither fair nor true. How on earth was his government supposed to have stopped that bridge collapsing? It was outrageous for anybody to suggest that they were not spending enough on bridges. The bridge was less than 10 years old. The best experts were at a loss to explain why it had snapped cleanly in two, sending a dozen cars into the watery depths of the river below. Okay. Are we explicitly told the occupants of those cars die? No, we are not. Is it assumed?
Well, yeah. when you're in a chunk of metal that's been dropped into an ocean with you inside, not an ocean, a river, with you inside it, it's hard to survive that.
Okay, you know, be smart, keep the windows up, you've got a little bit of oxygen for a while, the car will float.
I don't think Mythbusters have been aired yet.
So... how dared anyone suggest it was a lack of policemen that had resulted in those two very nasty and well-publicized murders? We're going to hear about those later. Or that the government should have somehow foreseen the freak hurricane in the West Country that had caused so much damage to both people and property. How often does England have hurricanes?
They don't.
Yeah, they don't. They're too far north. Okay? A grim mood has gripped the country. Why?
Dementors.
Okay? So, we hear the little portrait on the wall speak, saying to the Prime Minister of Muggles, urgent we meet, kindly respond, immediately, sincerely Fudge. Prime Minister, that's not a good time. I'm waiting for a telephone call, you see, from the President of, doesn't get finished. Who do we think it probably is. It's probably the president of the United States, simply because there aren't that many presidents of other countries. Most of them have prime ministers, okay? That can be rearranged. Don't worry about it, in other words. So, Fudge shows up. And the prime minister shakes Fudge's hand. And notice what Fudge is doing. He's sitting there with his bowler hat and he's just playing with it because he's so nervous. Fudge, difficult to know where to begin. What a week. Had a bad one too, have you? Yes, of course. I've been having the same week you have, Prime Minister. What has she just done? Exactly. She merged those two worlds. Remember in the previous book, Harry is dumbstruck when he hears Aunt Petunia say, you know, the Dementors guard the Wizarding Prison Azkaban. And this fiction he had created that the worlds were separate just gets destroyed. Some of your people were involved in those things, were they? Okay. And then we get several pages devoted to the Prime Minister's previous history with Fudge. When Fudge first showed up, okay, essentially 4 years ago. Okay. And then he shows up again, and then he shows up again, and then he shows up again. He shows up and tells him Voldemort's back. He shows up and tells him there's been a mass breakout from Azkaban prison and such. Okay. So, go on to roughly around page, somewhere between 9 and 11. And the Prime Minister thinks he's talking about Sirius Black still. He goes, Black? Don't worry about Black. Black's dead, but we were mistaken about Black. Mistaken? Really? Murdered. So he goes on and explains that Voldemort has now been joined by these people who broke out from Azkaban. And they've been wreaking havoc. Since they moved into the open, they've been wreaking havoc. The Brockdale Bridge, he did it, Prime Minister. He threatened a mass muggle killing unless I stood aside for him. Good grief, so it's your fault those people were killed. And I'm having to answer questions about rusted rigging and corroded expansion joints. And I don't know what else. Okay? This world is bleeding into, let's say, the real world. If you think of them this way, the wizarding world and the muggle world. Okay. Who did Dumbledore defeat in 1945? Grindelwald. Any similarity? Any relation between the defeat of the dark wizard Grindelwald and the defeat of the
Nazi regime?
Yeah. Okay. She does this throughout the novels. She kind of does this correspondence between events in our world and events in the wizarding world. Okay. So they keep talking. Fudge, you say I should have caved in to blackmail? Well, maybe not, but I would have put all my efforts into catching the blackmailer. You don't think I did it? Did he? When has Fudge put all his efforts into stopping Voldemort?
Never.
Well, maybe between the end of book 5 and the start of this, he's actually done something. But what are we going to find out in just a couple of pages? He's been sacked. Okay. What did Dumbledore tell him at the end of book 4? Take these steps, he says, and you will go down in history as one of the greatest ministers of magic we've ever had. Don't take these steps, and you get sacked. Okay. So, they keep talking, and Fudge mentions, you know, the stuff going off in the West Country. We've got most of the Department for the Regulation and Control of Magical Creatures running around Somerset, but we can't find the giant. It's been a disaster. You don't say. I won't deny morale is pretty low at the ministry, what with all that, and then losing Amelia Bones. Who? Amelia Bones, head of the Department of Magical Law Enforcement. The woman who said, you can produce a corporeal Patronus. The woman whose niece goes to school with Harry. Okay. How was she killed?
In battle.
The Muggle world has no idea. What did they discover?
Voldemort killed her personally?
Nope. Not in the Muggle world.
In the Muggle world, they just found a
locked house.
Yeah, she was killed.
From the inside. No sign of struggle, no sign of fight, no sign of entry wound or exit wound or any wound. She just up and died. Other than she looked scared to death. Okay. And he says, and then there's Emmeline Vance. Maybe you didn't hear about that one. Oh, yes, I did. Papers had a field day with that. And we've got Dementors swarming all over the place, attacking people left and right. I thought they guarded the wizard prison. They did, but they don't anymore. Okay? That's why there's so much gloom throughout the country. Maybe there are Dementors swirling around, you know, the United States today. So, Fudge says, I've been sacked. There's going to be a new prime minister. Scrimgeour, Rufus Scrimgeour, shows up. He looks like an old lion. Implying what about him? Gryffindor. Gryffindor, okay. What else?
Proud.
Okay. What else? An old lion. Why not an old peacock?
I guess he's almost disheveled.
He's not a fop.
He's kind of disheveled. He's not a fop. He's not a fool. Lions are fierce. He's going to get the job done. Okay?
Can I
go ahead.
I mean, this really has nothing to do with anything, but it says that when he was talking about what the Muggle papers had released about Amelia Bones, it says it was a nasty killing, wasn't it? So doesn't that imply that maybe it was at the top of my page 14.
But that murder was in the newspapers. Our newspapers, Amelia Bones, it just said she was a middle-aged woman who lived alone. It was a nasty killing, wasn't it? It's had a lot of publicity. But here's what Fudge says. Well, of course they are. Killed in a room that was locked from the inside, wasn't she? We, on the other hand, know exactly who did it. Not that that gets us any further towards catching him. And then there was Emmeline Vance. Maybe you didn't hear about that one. Okay. I think the nasty killing part is the thing about it being in a locked room. I don't think he means nasty. There's blood and gore all over the place.
Okay.
Voldemort doesn't do that. He doesn't play with his food before he kills it. He just, you know, kills it outright, so to speak.
One curse point, he's dead.
Why does he
But know? If it was just if it wasn't a nasty killing, wouldn't it just have looked as if an old woman died alone in her house?
Mm-mm. What happens to everyone who suffers Avada Kedavra? Eyes are wide open, and their arms are usually spread eagled.
Yeah, but...
People don't die that way.
People don't die that way. However, if she didn't have some wound, or if it weren't a nasty killing, wouldn't the Muggle police immediately go, that's a dead woman with no wounds, alone in her house? There wouldn't be any publicity for that.
Oh, heart attack.
No, I
didn't. Perhaps she thinks she saw a ghost and died.
Yeah, I see where you're going.
Died of a heart attack.
Think of what happened with Frank Bryce and
exactly.
The Riddles.
Yeah.
Riddles died the exact same way, but there were three of them.
Jim
Plasma.
Okay. I was just wondering.
That's fine.
That verbiage.
Chapter 2. Look at the title. So the first chapter, the other minister, which takes us to this world, and we see the activities of the wizarding world affecting the muggle world. What do the wizards care more about seemingly than anything?
Keeping a secret.
Yeah, keeping their identity secret. Okay. Chapter 2, Spinner's End. What does the title mean? First, what does it mean literally? And then what does it kind of mean symbolically or figuratively?
The thorax of a spider? No.
Okay, possibly. What's it mean literally?
The top of the top is what I think.
It's a place. What's the place?
It's a neighborhood at the end of cul-de-sac.
Yeah, it's a street. It's the street that Snape lives on. And he lives at the end of the street. Okay, the street kind of dead ends into Snape's house. Describe the buildings on the street.
Dilapidated.
It's a nice way of putting it. It's almost an approved way of putting it. They're run down. And notice we get they apparate to the street. This is around page 2021. But Narcissa had rushed ahead. Rubbing her hand, her pursuer followed again, keeping her distance now, as they moved deeper into the deserted labyrinth of brick houses. At last, Narcissa hurried up a street called Spinner's End, over which the towering mill chimney seemed to hover like a giant admonitory finger. Her footsteps echoed on the cobbles as she passed boarded and broken windows until she reached the very last house. Now, is this mill chimney from the mill on the actual street? Or is the mill somewhere nearby, but the chimney is so tall that it kind of casts this shadow, so to speak? It's not exactly clear. But how are all the buildings on the street described?
Boarded and broken.
Boarded and broken down. Okay. Why does Snape live here? Yes.
I was just going to provide a little site, ample insight, like historically speaking, how Britain was and industrialization, everything. They would have houses for the workers to live there, and then once the mill ran down or went out, then people would leave. So it's probably like kind of an old-ish mill town or like a mill area.
Who else grew up near here? Okay, I think it's pretty clear. This is Snape's family home. Lily grew up in this area. Because they played as children by probably the same little stream that we get at the beginning of the chapter that Narcissa and Bellatrix are at. Okay? Probably. Not necessarily. So describe Snape's house. Has it changed from the time when he was a little boy cowering in the corner? Apparently not. All right. So Spinner's Inn literally is the name of the street. What is it figuratively? Look at this word first. Okay. Literally, it's the end of Spinner's End that Snape lives at. Okay. But what else does end mean? You know, you could say top, bottom.
Beginning, end.
You could say beginning, end. Okay? So it's the finished part. It's completed part. Okay? That's one meaning of end. What's another one? Like means and ends? What's the end in that case? That is, what is the ultimate end of this container?
To provide water? To contain water?
To contain liquid. Do they have water? You never know. Could be water. Once out of college, bring a can of Coke to class every day. Sip from a straw. It wasn't Coke. Right? So the end there means what? It's purpose. Spinner's End. So, completion is one meaning. Purpose? Spinners. What are spinners? Michelangelo already mentioned spiders. Okay. The spinner's end could be the part of the spider's abdomen where the web shoots out. Okay. So what do spiders spin?
Webs.
What do they do with them?
Catch prey.
They catch prey with them. Okay. What else spins?
Top.
A top. Thread. Like a spinning wheel. Okay. If this were a wheel, like Fortune's wheel,
right.
Medieval image, it always spins. And as it spins, what does it do? It changes people's fortune. Okay? Who's spinning the web? If there is one being spun.
Snape.
Notice it's spun, it's not spinned. Okay. Is it Snape spinning the web? Who comes to Snape's house?
Bellatrix
and Narcissa. Why?
To try and save Draco.
Okay, to try and save Draco. So, what's the web being spun?
Voldemort.
Is it Voldemort? Does Voldemort know they're there?
Oh,
no. Would Voldemort be happy if he knew they were there?
No,
he would not. Okay. So who's spinning? Okay, there's not just one answer. There are multiple answers here.
Narcissa.
And I'm going to, okay. Narcissa. What is she spinning?
She's trying to save Draco.
So she's spinning a web of protection for her son. How does she think she's going to do that? What does she get Snape to agree to do?
To protect him and then to step in if he can
help. The unbreakable
vow. Okay. What does Snape agree to? And we're going to have to go to book 7 for some of this.
To step in if he can't complete the task.
To save Draco's soul.
To save Draco. To save Draco from what?
Death. Having his soul ripped apart.
Okay, having his soul ripped apart. Okay, let me back up a little bit. If Draco can't do the deed that Voldemort wants him to do, Snape agrees to do it for him. What's the deed Voldemort wants Draco to do?
Kill Dumbledore.
Okay, that's the bigger part of the web. Notice, where is Draco in this web?
He's caught
in it.
He's the net.
He's in the web. Okay, so now Snape is brought into the web. Okay. Is Snape doing any spinning?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, he is. How so?
He's pretending to be a spy.
Okay, he's pretending to be a spy. Is Snape there for the same reason? Or is Snape agreeing to the unbreakable vow for the same reason that Narcissa? No. No. Okay. Who else is spinning?
Dumbledore.
How about Dumbledore? This is where we have to go to book 7. Because we find out in book 7, when Bellatrix and Narcissa arrive, what does Snape already know?
That Draco has to kill Dumbledore.
Okay.
That Dumbledore is dying.
Next chapter, when Dumbledore shows up to pick up Harry, Harry notices something about his hand. What's wrong with his hand?
It's all withered.
It's withered and blackened. Okay? Why?
It's cursed.
Because he tried to crack open the ring. What happened the moment he tried to break the Horcrux? He started to die. I mean, you could say he started to die the day he was born. That's the way I look at it. Okay?
He started to die quicker.
But he started to die more quickly. Thank you.
In a very tangible sense.
Thank you.
Apparently his hand's just turning to crying.
Yeah. In a very tangible sense. Okay? So, Snape knows that. Dumbledore knows that. In fact, we find out later that when that happens, how much time does Dumbledore have?
About a year.
Yeah. Maybe a year. When did that happen? We're not given an exact date. but it's between the end of Order of the Phoenix and the beginning of this book.
Sometime
it can only be about a month because he's only been at the Aaron was only at the Dursleys for, he says, a fortnight, so he hasn't.
That's
been
2 weeks. So if Harry was only there for 2 weeks before Dumbledore comes to collect him, he was only home for 2 weeks, okay?
It was like the first thing he did after terms.
Yeah, it's pretty quick. So we've got Narcissa weaving a web, spinning a web. We've got Snape spinning away. We've got Dumbledore spinning away. Notice, who does Dumbledore kind of suck into the web?
Harry.
Harry?
Snape.
Everybody's trying to use Snape.
Why does Dumbledore get Snape to agree to the unbreakable vow? You can only answer this from books.
To ban Voldemort's...
To protect Draco. And we're going to see that scene where he's going to say, you know, I will not have that boy's soul ripped apart on my behalf. And Snape says, what about my soul, Dumbledore? Pretty powerful scene, okay? And Dumbledore says, only you know what will happen to your soul if you kill me, okay? Let's jump to that for a moment. When Snape agrees to kill Dumbledore, is he agreeing to murder?
No.
Is he agreeing to euthanasia?
Maybe. More so.
Okay, think about it for a moment. What is euthanasia? I mean, literally, you, beautiful Thanos, death.
A
beautiful death.
A proper and dignified death instead of whatever necrotic infection Dumbledore has.
Well, possibly. It's romanticized. Euthanasia, as it's commonly practiced today, in the states that allow it, or in the countries that allow it, and some countries are, you know, they're taking euthanasia, and it's getting really scary, Netherlands as an example. Do you have to be terminal in the sense that you've got 2 weeks?
No.
Do you have to be terminal in the sense that you only have a year? Do you have to be terminal in the sense that you're in agonizing pain? No. Do you actually even have to be terminal? No.
Technically,
you do not. Well, yeah, I mean, that's all terminal. You do not. Okay. How terminal is Dumbledore?
Rather.
Right. He's got this going on. What else does he have going on?
150 years.
Cave.
Oh, yeah.
That was poison that he drank. Okay. Which is why he says, you must get me to Severus. What is Severus throughout books 1 through 5?
Ocean Master.
He needs Severus either for the potion or, okay, and if you were Drax, you wouldn't get that.
I would mess.
So, is it euthanasia or is it akin to not prolonging death? See, when you have a family member, we had this with my grandmother, when you have a family member who is quote-unquote terminal or dying or on life support, and the life support keeping being plugged in is merely keeping that person alive. Are they keeping that person alive or are they keeping death from taking its natural course? If you pull the plug out and they stop, that's stopping death from taking its natural course. If you pull the plug out and they keep going on their own, what's that mean?
They're alive.
The plug was never doing anything. Yeah, it might have been helping them breathe, you know, so to speak. Okay? I was telling my class this morning, there was a case just a year or two ago. And I can't remember what state, but it was somebody who'd been in a vegetative state for like 20 years. And I mean, they were as aware as this desk. Okay? And they woke up. And woke up like nobody's ever woke up before. Woke up totally aware, totally capable, totally competent, and heard every word that was said around their hospital bed about, should we? Well, if we unplug them now, we can use a liver, use a kidney, use a heart, use some lungs, and the person's lying there, not able to do a thing. Okay? Dumbledore, obviously, is not in that position, but where is he? This has been going on for approximately 9 months. It has spread. He's drunk the poison. He's a dead man walking. So when he says, Severus, please, he's saying, end it. End it. Okay? He's not saying, oh, Severus, be merciful, you know, take away my suffering. He's saying, whether it's you or tomorrow, but when we see those memories of Snape, what else does he say? Rather you than what? Anybody remember? Fenrir Greyback getting his teeth into me. Because he is someone who likes to play with his food, apparently, before he kills it. Okay? So you have all these spinners going on. Okay? I think she does that, and she uses that language because she wants to draw us into this idea of the fates. Three fates, Greek mythology. Clotho, the spinner of each person's life. The Greeks thought we each had a life that was a thread. Okay? Lachesis is the one who measures our thread, and Actopos, the one who comes up with the nice little scissors and goes, clip. Where? Lachesis says, to cut. Okay? Notice, we're talking about the cutting in this chapter. Because Narcissa wants to protect him. Her son, Draco. What does that show? Sacrifice? Possible. What else? Love. It's even more simple. Love! Okay, it's her son, though. Yep. But it's still love. It shows Narcissa is still capable of love. Do we see anywhere in the novels, or in this novel and later, where Lucius Malfoy is? Do we ever see him kind of step out in defense of Draco? No, we don't. We see times when he's protective of himself. He doesn't want to give up his own wand, you know. But we don't see many where he comes to the defense of Draco. Where do we see this love by Narcissa ultimately shown?
Is my son okay?
Yeah.
Is he still alive?
He's dead, my lord. Which really doesn't make sense when you come to think about it. Because after all, don't lie to me, fool. I'm Lord Voldemort. I always know the truth. I always know when somebody's lying. So why doesn't he know then?
He was being cocky at that moment.
Was it being cocky? Is it because it was love? And love hid her? Or is that just a plot hole?
Is it a plot hole? A piece of bad writing?
Blind faces followers.
So, we're going to skip a bunch. So, Snape agrees. Okay? Chapter 3, Will and Won't. Dumbledore arrives at Harry's house. Harry does not tell the Dursleys. And this is, where is this? This is around page 45 or so. Dumbledore knocks on the door. They answer. He's standing there. Judging by your look of stunned disbelief, Harry did not warn you that I was coming. However, let us assume that you invited me warmly into your house. It is unwise to linger overlong on doorsteps in these troubled times. And he walks in. Okay? So he's standing there. He's just standing there. They're not saying anything to him. Dumbledore sees Harry. He addresses him. Finally, Vernon. I don't mean to be rude, yet sadly accidental rudeness occurs alarmingly often. One of my favorite lines in the entire series. What does rolling mean? How often do people actually intend to be rude? They don't. Most people aren't that bad-natured. Yet, rudeness happens, let's say.
And oftentimes when someone's about to say, I don't mean to be rude, they're about to say something rude.
They're about, exactly.
That's okay. Like, with all due respect.
Best to say nothing at all, my dear man. And then Petunia comes in. And he says, we have corresponded, of course. Really? Yes. We do come to find out that Petunia had written Dumbledore, and Dumbledore has written back letter with Harry and the Howler. Okay? So, he draws up a chair for himself. They all sit down. He makes the couch scoot up to them so they sit. He draws also up son of Madame Rosmerta's mead. And so the three Dursleys are sitting there, and the glasses are just kind of floating in midair until they start banging them on the heads. Okay. And Vernon says, around 48, 49, will you get these ruddy things off? Oh, I'm so sorry. Would have been better managed to drink it, you know. What is Dumbledore doing throughout this whole interview with the Dursleys? And through him, rolling to her readers.
Teaching.
She's teaching manners. She's teaching proper behavior. Where did this start? Well, take a minute. Might not have started here, but we see it in book three. When Mr. Weasley, in Vernon's mind, attempts to show consideration or to teach consideration, when he says, wait, you're not going to see your nephew for an entire year. Aren't you going to say goodbye? And Vernon's, you know, trying to work out this guy teaching me consideration when he blew apart half my living room. All right? She does this throughout. What is she doing? She's teaching manners, first of all, to young readers. Maybe who don't have any. Okay? What else is she doing? She's teaching parenting. Okay? To possibly parents who are reading their children's books that maybe she thinks don't have very good manners themselves or good parenting skills. Because notice how often this idea of how adults should treat children comes up. Whenever Molly Weasley is around, it comes up. Often when Sirius is around, it comes up. It's going to come up at the end of book 7. And it's going to come up at the beginning of book 7. When Harry has a nice little conversation with Remus Lupin. Not so nice. When he makes Lupin leave. Because he wants Lupin to do what? Stay with your child. All right? So, why is Dumbledore there? Just to collect Harry?
No. He tells them that he's aware that he knows that they didn't take care of him the way they asked him to.
Yeah, we're going
to
get to that later. Oh. Will or won't? What's the chapter title about? Will Creature obey Harry, or won't he?
Okay.
Harry has inherited everything of the Black family. He now owns number 12 Grimmauld Place. He now has all the money that was in the bank in Gringotts. He also now has a house elf of his own. Okay? Imagine this isn't Harry, but this is Malfoy. Draco, not Lucius. And he has a house elf of his own. What would somebody like Draco do? Okay, and?
Abuse power immediately.
Go get my enemy, you know. Go attack. Okay? Harry doesn't want creature. He doesn't want 12 Grimmauld Place. But.
It'll be a nice house if it weren't so freaking pressing.
Yeah, and associated with demon worship, essentially. But creature does obey Harry. So he is bound to Harry, and Harry commands him to go back. And then Dumbledore addresses the Dursleys. It says, Harry comes of age in a year's time. About 52 or so. Petunia, no he doesn't. He's a month younger than Dudley. Dudley doesn't turn 18 until the year after next. In the wizarding world, it happens when we're 17. Okay. So he says, now as you already know, the wizard called Lord Voldemort has returned to this country. Wizarding community is currently in a state of open warfare. Harry, whom Lord Voldemort has already attempted to kill on a number of occasions, is even greater danger now than the day when I left him upon your doorstep. With the letter explaining his parents' murder and expressing the hope that you would care for him as though he were your own. He pauses. Why? Let that sink in and dramatic effect. Just get a little bit of silence. Notice the Dursleys draw tighter together. It's like they sense what's coming. You did not do as I asked. You have never treated Harry as a son. He has known nothing but neglect and often cruelty at your hands. The best that can be said is that he has at least escaped the appalling damage you have inflicted upon the unfortunate boy sitting between you. Dudley sitting there, what? They look, Vernon and Petunia look at each other and they're like, what appalling damage? Us? Mistreat gutters? What do you... Dumbledore. So he talks about the magic and he says when Harry turns 17, that magic will stop. And he'll be able to be attacked. So he says, I have one request. Allow Harry to come back once more. Okay? Before his 17th birthday. To ensure that the protection continues until that time. None of the Dursleys said anything. Dudley's frowning, still trying to work out when he had ever been mistreated. Uncle Vernon looked as though he had something stuck in his throat. Aunt Petunia, however, was oddly flushed. Why is she flushed? What is she experiencing?
She's embarrassed.
She's embarrassed. Why is she embarrassed?
Basically.
Okay, so is it really embarrassment?
Shame.
It's shame. What's the difference between shame and embarrassment? Embarrassment, you know, you walk off, you know, have this dream about once a year. I still have this dream about once a year. I show up to school and I don't have any clothes on. Or I show up to school and somebody from one of my previous colleges where I got my degrees says, you never completed X requirement, which means everything after that point, null and void. Okay? It's like I said, about once a year. Okay? That's embarrassment. It's terrifying. What's shame? Is shame regret?
There's regret in it.
I can regret not buying a particular car.
It's guilt.
It's I did something I should not have done. Or I didn't do something I should have done. But notice Petunia is the only one who feels it.
She owed it to her sister.
So they go off. They go to Horace Slughorn's house, and we're going to skip all of that chapter.
I clearly
Well, I'll take that back. We'll skip all that chapter except for about page 74 or so. Harry and Dumbledore are talking, and Dumbledore says it's cruel that you and Sirius had so short time together. And Harry, Bob, towards the end of that page, while I was at the Dursleys, I realized I can't shut myself away or crack up. Sirius wouldn't want that, would he? And anyway, life's too short. Look at Madame Bones. Look at Emily Vance. It could be me next, couldn't it? And he looks into Dumbledore's eyes, and Harry says, I'll make sure I take as many Death Eaters with me as I can. And Voldemort, too, if I can manage it. You know. What does Dumbledore say? Spoken by both like your mother and father's son in Sirius's true godson. What kind of speech is it? Empty. Yes.
Where are you?
Should be around page 74.
77.
77? Really?
I got 78.
Yeah, 78 in ours, in the British one. It's empty. How do I know it's empty? What does Harry do in book 7? He's going to take as many Death Eaters as he can. How many Death Eaters does Harry take? Zip. Why? Because he told us at the end of book 5. I can't kill anyone. Okay. What did the prophecy say? The Dark Lord will mark him as his equal, and he will have a power and skill the Dark Lord knows not. Power, skill. Two different things. Dumbledore tells us what the power is. Love. It's his ability to love. He doesn't tell us what the skill is. Okay? I think that comes later.
The skill of not killing your enemies.
Mercy.
Related to that. Okay? So, Dumbledore tells Harry, tell your friends, Harry. Share what you have to do with Ron and Hermione. You're going to need them. Chapter 5. They arrive at the burrow, and we get an excess of phlegm. Okay? Bill is getting married to Fleur. Nobody in the family, apparently, likes Fleur, except for Bill. And Harry gets his owls, page 102. He does pretty well. Okay. The only ones he doesn't do so hot on are divination, poor, and history of magic, dreadful. How important are divination and history of magic? Not at all. Okay. Chapter 6, Draco's Detour. They go off to Diagon Alley, and Harry watches Draco out of the window of Fred and George's joke shop, and he follows Draco. And Draco goes right into Borgin and Burke's. And Harry spies on him, and he thinks Draco's trying to sneak something into the school. He's partly right, but he's partly wrong. Okay? He jumps to conclusions. So, when it's time to get on the train, he gets on the train. We have the Slug Club, okay, which I'm going to skip. And Harry sneaks into Draco's compartment. Has his cloak on, his invisibility cloak. He's up on that top bunk, and the train stops as they get to Hogsmeade. Harry looks over the edge of the luggage rack, because he wants to see what Malfoy's been hiding from Pansy Parkinson. And as he does, Malfoy curses him with Petrificus Totalus, freezes him. Harry falls off the bunk. What does Malfoy do? I mean, it's pretty brutal, even for Malfoy.
breaks his nose.
Stomps on his face. I mean, it's an image right out of Orwell's 1984. Okay? Blood spurting everywhere. That's from my father. Where is Draco's father?
Christian.
Okay. Pulls the cloak out and covers Harry up. Why?
No one
will see him. The cloak blends in with its surroundings. Okay. Tonks comes and rescues him. She takes Harry up to the school. Well, not quite. She takes Harry up to Snape. And we're told, around page 160 or so, when Harry meets Snape and Tonks leaves, that they don't speak for a moment to each other, and that Harry still thinks Snape didn't alert the Order of the Phoenix as quickly as he could have. Harry clung to this notion because it enabled him to blame Snape, which felt satisfying. And also because he knew that if anyone was not sorry that Sirius was dead, it was the man now striding next to him in the darkness. And so what does Snape do? Okay, Harry didn't arrive on the school-approved method of transportation. And so he takes 50 points from being late, and he takes 20 points from not being in school attire. So Harry starts the school year off losing 70 points from Gryffindor. But Harry doesn't tell Snape about why he's dressed the way he is. We're told the fury and hatred bubbling inside Harry seemed to blaze white hot, but he'd rather have been immobilized all the way back to London than tell Snape why he was late. Do you think Snape knows why he was late? What did Snape prove? Okay. When he was trying to teach Harry occlumency lessons? He's Legilimens. Do you have to go Legilimens or Legilimens? No, because what do they learn in this year?
You can do spells without words.
They learn nonverbal spells. Okay? So it's pretty likely, I think, Snape knows what happened. Notice what else happens. Or let me put it this way. What else doesn't happen? Harry doesn't learn about it till later. What did all the other students have to go through before they arrived at Hogwarts?
Security
check. What kind of security check?
Search.
Okay, what kind? Are we talking body cavity search? No. Wanding. What kind of wand? To detect what?
Dark arts.
Dark arts. Why does Harry not go through this? Okay. Ostensibly, plot, because he's late. Okay. What other plot reason?
He's got the invisibility cloak.
I mean, he
is
the chosen one.
He's got the curse. The...
He's a Horcrux.
Yeah.
That's about as dark an object as there can be. Okay. And so if they came up to him, stand here, we're going to do this. I mean, the thing would be going bonkers. Okay? Plot device entirely for that. Yes?
So I'm thinking back to the lessons that Snape was giving Harry. And when he was performing Legilimency on him, Harry was aware that he was in his mind. Is that a more powerful version of it? Because obviously in every other sense, when he does it silently, he's reading Harry's current thoughts without Harry being aware that he's being read.
I don't know. It was either earlier in this book. No, it's in Order of the Phoenix. You know, Dumbledore also tells Harry, you know, I'm an accomplished enough Legilimens that I was able to, what? Get information from creature. Okay? What does that tell us? Well, you could go back to book two. Harry goes up to Dumbledore's office, and Dumbledore says, Harry, is there anything you want to tell me? Anything at all? Harry's like, let's see, I'm hearing voices. and nobody else hears. No, no, nothing at all. Does Dumbledore know Harry? Yes, he does. Okay. So, Dumbledore talks about the security situation. It's dangerous. Students shouldn't be out of bed after dark. Students should, you know, if they notice anything strange or suspicious within or outside the castle, report it to a member of staff immediately, blah, 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 blah. Okay? I've just got to add this. This book came out in 2005. Okay? Came out in, it was mid to late June. Mid to late July, 2005. When I taught my Harry Potter course in London that year, I got a call. Let's see. We left to fly over on July 8th. I got a call about 6 o'clock in the morning on July 7th. I was still in bed because I wasn't teaching, obviously, that day. Got a call. Have you seen the news? No. Turn on the TV. Turned on the TV. It was the London bombings. Okay, on the tube and a couple of buses. Started watching the news. Got another call a few hours later. As of right now, we're going, but it may change. You know, we were supposed to leave about 5 hours after that. Okay? We got to London the following morning, and I've been to London 4 or 5 times before that. When I got to London this time, it was a London I'd never seen before. Okay? Cops everywhere. And I mean everywhere. We got into Heathrow and there would be cops walking down, you know, the big wide walkways you have in airports. There would be 4 and 5 cops walking abreast with semiotic weapons with their fingers on the trigger guard. You don't see weapons in London. Well, rephrase that. You didn't see weapons in London prior to that. You'd go downtown London. I mean, this was the first day. You know, we got checked into our stuff, and then we'd take students off on a walking tour to get them familiarized with the area we'd stay in. I'd always take them to the tube stop so they could validate what's called their travel card. And sometimes take them on a short tube ride. We started seeing then, inside the trains, inside the carriages, constant vigilance. Okay? If you see anything at all remotely suspicious, tell somebody, kind of a thing. So, you know, people would leave, you know, they'd go to McDonald's, they get a McDonald's bag, they eat their food, and they'd leave the bag on a bench or on a chair in a train station. That immediately becomes suspect. Okay? So they have to clear the area and make sure it's literally just a piece of trash. Okay? What Dumbledore describes here is almost perfectly describing the situation in London at that time. You go down into central London, you go down to Oxford Street, the main shopping thoroughfare, just covered with tourists. And you can look up on the buildings, like on Selfridge's department store. It's one of the biggest department stores in England. And there'd be snipers. Snipers. Okay? You go downtown by Downing Street, where the Prime Minister lives, and there'd be a sniper on every single corner of a building. Helicopters circling overhead. Okay? Like I said, prior to the bombing, it was never like that. I was in London in 2002, a year after 9/11. Didn't see any cops with weapons. Batons, yes, but no handguns. Okay? So this novel kind of took on, okay, that whole atmosphere. Harry doesn't tell them how he got his nose broken and stuff. Hermione fixes it for him. And then we get the next chapter, Half-Blood Prince. And around page 173, okay, Neville is talking to McGonagall because she's going over their schedules for the courses they're going to have, they're going to take this year. And Neville wants to take a newt in Transfiguration. Nastily exhausting wizarding tests. And she says, I don't think you could do it. And then she asks, why do you want to continue with Transfiguration? I've never had the impression you particularly enjoyed it. And he mutters something about his grandmother. It's high time your grandmother learned to be proud of the grandson she's got, rather than the one she thinks she ought to have. Notice she doesn't stop there. If she stopped there, what would the import of this little speech be? It could be, you know, Neville, you're the best she's going to get. Not that ringing of an endorsement. But she pauses, probably for emphasis, and then says, particularly after what happened at the ministry. Well, what happened at the ministry?
Neville's
a badass. Neville took on Death Eaters. Okay. How has Neville changed from book one? Films. How does Neville change from film one to film six? He got hot. The example I used in my class this morning was, look at Neville in film one. Look at Neville today. You would never say that was Neville. Mm-hmm. You know, as I said in class, he's gorgeous. You would never have expected. Okay? So what is Neville? What two-word term do we use to describe people like Neville? Late bloomer. Okay? Because frankly, Daniel Radcliffe's not much taller than he was when he was 11. I mean, I'm not kidding. He stands about like this on me. Okay? Neville's, I think like 6'2", 6'4", something like that. She then goes on.
Lucky with that,
dude. Yeah. Neville turns pink. And she says, I'm sorry, I can't let you in. Well, how about a Newton Charms? You did well in Charms. My grandmother thinks Charms is a soft option. Okay. Now listen to what she says. Take Charms, and I shall drop Augusta a line. Okay, notice. She refers to his grandmother first name, okay, reminding her that just because she failed her charms owl, the subject is not necessarily worthless. Did Neville fail his charms owl? No, he did what? Exceeds expectations. Okay. Now, granted, exceeds expectations can mean what?
B.
Harry exceeds expectations in Snape's potions. What does that mean?
Snape
has low expectations. He could set his cauldron up, you know. No, I mean, there are objective criteria to get that exceeds expectation. So what has she just done?
Elevated.
Neville, you're better than your grandmother.
Also, his grandmother only hates Charles because she failed and she has a crutch.
Okay. What did her grandmother say to Harry, Ron, Hermione, Ginny, about Neville on Christmas on the Closed Ward? He doesn't have his father's talent, but he's a good boy. Right? What did Dumbledore tell Harry at the end of Book 2? It is our choices, Harry, far more than our abilities, that show what we truly are. What did Neville choose to do at the end of the previous book? He chose to defend Harry. He chose to go rescue someone, what? He'd never met. He didn't know Sirius Black. At all. Okay. So, Harry goes off to potions. New potions teacher, Horace Slughorn. He didn't know he's going to be taking potions, so he doesn't have a textbook. So he goes to the cupboard in the back and he pulls one out. Okay. He also has Defense Against the Dark Arts, who finally gets to teach it?
Snape.
Okay. And we get the House of Gaunt. Chapter 10. Harry shows up to Dumbledore's office for his first lesson. You know, what goes through Harry's mind when Dumbledore says, I'm going to be giving you private lessons?
Defense and special spells. Special.
Okay. What experience has he just, relatively recently, within the last 3 or 4 months, what experience has he had with Dumbledore? What did he see Dumbledore do that really nobody else got to see?
He could fight.
He got to see him take on Voldemort. He got to see Dumbledore do spells. And he's probably thinking, yes, if I can learn some of that, I'll be okay. Instead, what does Dumbledore teach him? Essentially.
Life and Times of Thomas Riddle.
The Life and Times of Tom Riddle. Or, another way of putting that, kind of Dumbledore's version of History of Magic, which Harry got a dreadful in. So, Dumbledore says, Harry, this time you're going to enter the Pensieve with me. And with permission. Where are we going? For a trip down Bob Ogden's memory lane. This is 94, 95, 96, somewhere around 198. Okay. Worked for the Department of Magical Law Enforcement. So, they go in. They see Bob Ogden. They see him walk down. They see him go to this old, dilapidated shack. Somebody says, you're not welcome. But he doesn't understand what the person is saying. Harry does, however. Okay. You understand him, I'm sure, Harry. Why can't Ogden? He's speaking parts of the tongue. Okay. So, we meet Marvolo Gaunt, his son, Morfin, and his daughter, Merope. Notice the alliteration in their names. Okay. And we watch the whole vision, and I'm going to skip most of the actual vision or the memory. And around page 210 or so, Dumbledore and Harry come out of the vision. Might be 212. Okay. Dumbledore says, I think that will do, Harry. Harry, what happened to the girl in the cottage? What happened to Merope in the vision? How was she treated by her brother and father?
Abused.
Okay. Dumbledore, she survived. Ogden apparated back to the ministry. They came back with reinforcements. Marvolo, who had injured several ministry employees in addition to Ogden, received 6 months in Azkaban. Marvolo, that's right. I'm glad to see you're keeping up. In other words, this is part of Dumbledore's way of teaching Harry. He's not explaining everything exactly. He's just talking and hoping Harry makes connections. Voldemort's grandfather, yes. Marvolo, his son Morfin, his daughter Merope were the last of the Gaunts, a very ancient wizarding family noted for a vein of instability and violence that flourished through the generations. She doesn't choose the name Gaunt, I don't think, by accident. Because there is the name Gaunt in British medieval history. John of Gaunt, Duke of Lancaster, okay, father of one of the major houses in the English Civil Wars of the Roses. Huge patron of the arts. Chaucer wrote a lot of stuff for him. He was called the Kingmaker. Okay. So, they keep talking. So, Merope, she was Voldemort's mother? It does. And did you catch the glimpse of Voldemort's father? The muggle, the man on the horse? Very good. That was Tom Riddle. And they ended up married? I think you're forgetting Merope was a witch. Does Dumbledore need to go on anymore? I do not believe her magical powers appear to their best advantage when she is being terrorized by her father. Can you not think of any measure Maripe could have taken to make Tom Riddle forget his muggle companion? What was one of the first things Slughorn showed them in potions?
No potion.
Harry, the Imperious Curse? Or a love potion? Dumbledore says, yep, I think it's the last one. So they got married. And Dumbledore goes on and says, actually, pick up with Harry. And Maripe, she died, didn't she? Wasn't Voldemort brought up in an orphanage? Yes, indeed. So notice, we must do a certain amount of guessing here. In other words, Dumbledore is constructing what?
Probable series of events.
Probable series of events. What's another way of putting that? Think of visual image.
Storyboard?
Puzzle. He's got a puzzle. It's got gaps in it. So the puzzle isn't completely filled up. Right? So he says, eventually Tom Riddle comes back home. Harry, but she had his baby.
Yes.
But not until a year after they were married. Tom Riddle left her while she was still pregnant. But what went wrong? Why did the love potion stop working? Guesswork again. In other words, I don't have the piece to put in the puzzle, but by looking at everything around it, I believe she made the choice to stop giving him the potion. Why?
She didn't want an empty love.
She didn't want an empty love? What did she expect would happen?
That
he'd love her on his own and stay. Perhaps besotted as she was, notice, she is madly in love with him. She had convinced herself he would by now have fallen in love with her in return. Perhaps she thought he would stay for the baby's sake. Wrong on both counts. That's enough for tonight, Harry. Harry's, okay, so, is it important to know all this about Voldemort's past? Very important. And it's got something to do with the prophecy. What's Harry thinking about the prophecy? He dies or I die. That's what it comes down to. Has everything to do with the prophecy. Okay. Can I tell Ron and Hermione? Yes. Harry looks at the ring on Dumbledore's little table. That ring, yes. You were wearing it when we visited Professor Slughorn, so I was. But isn't that the same ring Marvolo got showed Ogden? Have you always had it? No, I acquired it very recently. A few days before I came to fetch you, from your aunt and uncle's, in fact. About the time you hurt your hand. Around that time. Good night, Harry. Notice what he does. He allows Harry to ask questions so far, but not too far, to not get ahead. So Harry's now connected the ring with what? Well, not necessarily Voldemort, but Voldemort's grandfather. Okay. Chapter 11, Hermione's helping hand. And Harry, Ron, and Hermione are talking about the safety of the school and such, around page 221 or so. And Ron says, Hogwarts is safer than everyone's homes. We've got Dumbledore. Hermione, I don't think we've got him all the time. Meaning, haven't you noticed? Meals, sometimes Dumbledore's not there. Okay? Let's skip a bunch, because there's a lot here I don't want to talk about. Page, I think it's around 233. No, take that back, 237. Probably around 235. They're reading about a search of the Malfoy's house. And Hermione says, Harry says, well, if the thing Malfoy bought at Borgin and Burke's isn't at their house, then he must have brought it with him to Hogwarts. How can he have done, Harry? We were all searched when we arrived, weren't we? Were you? I wasn't. Oh, no, of course you weren't. I forgot. You were late. Well, Filch ran over all of us with secrecy sensors when we got in an entrance hall. Any dark object would have been found. Crab had a shrunken head, for example. Harry noticed, momentarily stymied, watched Ginny Weasley playing with Arnold the Pygmy Puff. Okay. Silver and opals. Harry starts practicing some of the spells in the textbook that had the property of the Half-Blood Prince written on the bottom of it. And notice, he even does some of them on Ron, not knowing what they are. Levicorpus, Ron floats up from his bed and starts screaming. And Harry flips through the book and finds the antidote, Liber Corpus, free the body. Okay, and Ron falls. And Hermione tells him, page 240, that you shouldn't be using that book. Why? It's not Ministry of Magic approved. What does she sound like? And also because I'm starting to think this Prince character was a bit dodgy. Okay? Harry, I don't see where you get that from. Next page. If he'd been a budding Death Eater, he wouldn't have been boasting about being half-blood, would he? Would he? What's the half-blood he's boasting about, though? Ron, 240, somewhere around 243. We hear for the first time in the books, I think it is. Other than one earlier time when Hagrid said it, and it was written in dialect. Thank God. Let's stay here all afternoon. Where are they? They're in Hogsmeade. Okay. So what do they do in Hogsmeade? They go to the Three Broomsticks. Why? Good place for butter beer. Why else?
They can talk there.
They can talk there. Why else? Madame Rosmerta's kind of hot. And Ron likes to look at Madame Rosmerta. Okay. While they are there, Hermione appears out of nowhere. Excuse me, Tonks appears out of nowhere. Hold on, I just lost my page number. 243. And Katie Bell leaves. They see her scream. Hagrid comes in, picks her up. They take her to the school. Harry blames it all on Malfoy. What kind of proof does he have? I don't like him. You know, it's like that ought to be enough. Okay? So he doesn't have any proof. Chapter 13. Okay, we're skipping a lot because we can get through this in 2 days. If we can get through it in 1.5 days, that gives us more time for the final book, which we'll actually need. So, secret riddle, Harry goes on to his next lesson with Dumbledore. Picking up around page 260. Dumbledore says, "You will remember, I am sure, that we left the tale of Lord Voldemort's beginnings at the point where the handsome muggle, Tom Riddle, had abandoned his witch wife. Merope was left alone in London, expecting the baby who would one day become Lord Voldemort. How do you know she was in London? Because of the evidence, of one Caractacus Burke, who by odd coincidence helped found the very shop whence came the necklace we have just been discussing. The opal necklace?
Burke
from Borgin and Burke's. Okay? So, Dumbledore calls up the Pensieve and we see Caractacus Burke holding the Locket of Slytherin, saying she needed the gold badly. Well, that much was obvious. Covered in rags, pretty far along, going to have a baby, see? She said the locket had been Slytherin's. Well, we hear that sort of thing all the time. Oh, this was Merlin's, this was his favorite teapot, blah, 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 blah. Harry, he only gave her 10 galleons. Cheap. Caractacus Burke was not famed for his generosity. So, near the end of her pregnancy, she's in London, she's alone, desperate need of gold, so desperate that she's willing to sell her one and only valuable possession, Harry. But she could do magic. Okay? Book one, Harry asks why they need a ministry of magic. And Hagrid says, to keep ourselves secret from the Muggles. Otherwise, they'll be wanting magical solutions to all their problems. Notice what Harry's assuming here. Magic can solve all your problems. Okay? Dumbledore, perhaps you could. But it's my belief, again I'm guessing, this is around, like I said, 262 or so. I'm guessing that when her husband abandoned her, Merope stopped using magic. In other words, she made a choice to stop using magic. Why? Because she wanted to be a Muggle? We don't really know. Anyways, Dumbledore says, it's also possible that her unrequited love and the attendant despair sapped her of her powers. That can happen. Any case, as you're about to see, Merope refused to wear to... I got a few hours of sleep and my mouth's not agreeing with my mind. Merope refused to raise her wand, even to save her own life. She wouldn't even stay alive, Harry says, for her son. Look at look at Dumbledore's reply. Could you possibly be feeling sorry for Lord Voldemort? Notice Harry's response. No! Said Harry quickly. Why does he say it quickly?
He doesn't want to seem like he's sympathizing with the devil over here.
It's a knee-jerk reaction.
Is he feeling sorry for Lord Voldemort? Yes, he is. But she had a choice, didn't she? Not like my mother. Really? No, not Harry. Not Harry. Take me. No. That's all choice. Your mother had a choice too. Yes, Merope Riddle chose death in spite of a son who needed her. But do not judge her too harshly, Harry. She was greatly weakened by long suffering, and she never had your mother's courage. She was greatly weakened by long suffering. Has Harry had long suffering? Yes, he has. Has he had long suffering like Merope had? Is Vernon like Marvolo?
No.
No. Morphin might be kind of like Dudley, okay? Where are we going? This time you're going to come into one of my memories, Harry. And we see Dumbledore. The younger Albus Dumbledore's long hair, beard were auburn. Having reached their side of the street, he strode off along the pavement. Harry notices his suit, flamboyantly cut suit of plum velvet that he was wearing. Kind of helps explain when she later on outs Dumbledore as being gay. Rowling. Okay. So, Harry wants to know where they're going. I have an appointment with Mrs. Cole, who I believe is the matron here. Okay, they've knocked on an orphanage. Dumbledore goes in. What do we notice about Mrs. Cole? Describe her.
Cold, hard.
Cold.
Drunk.
Hard. Drunk.
Kind of like in Annie.
Yes, that's exactly
what I'm saying.
Little
caricature.
Little smell of gin about her. Okay? We're told a skinny, harassed-looking woman came scurrying towards them. She had a sharp-featured face, appeared more anxious than unkind, and she was talking over her shoulder to somebody else. Okay? Dumbledore shows her the letter and such. And she asks if Dumbledore's family. He says, no, I'm a teacher. I've come to offer Tom a place at my school. What school is this? It's called Hogwarts. How come you're in Tom? He has quality. Blah, 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 blah. Okay? Harry also notices that Dumbledore slips his wand out of his pocket. Okay? He uses it every now and then. He's kind of guiding Mrs. Cole. It soon became clear, page 263, Mrs. Cole was no novice when it came to gin drinking. Pouring both of them a generous measure, she drained her glass in one. That is, one gulp. Smacking her lips frankly, supposed to bring to mind who? Aunt Marge. She drained her glass. Frankly, she smiled at Dumbledore for the first time, and he didn't hesitate to press his advantage. So, Dumbledore goes and meets Tom Riddle. After she says, you know, weird things happen around him. Okay. Tom Riddle says, who are you? Why are you here? Dumbledore, I told you my name is Albus Dumbledore, Professor Dumbledore. I work at a school called Hogwarts. Okay. What does Riddle try to do? He tries to command. Okay. Dumbledore tells him, you're special. Wow, I knew I was different. I knew I was special. Okay. Dumbledore has to prove he is what he says he is. He says, you'll get a wand when you get to Hogwarts. Okay. But you can't use magic, blah, 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 blah. And then Tom Riddle says, somewhere around 275, probably. When Dumbledore tells him, go to the Leaky Cauldron and ask for Tom, the barman. I think the same barman is there when Harry goes to the Leaky Cauldron. Riddle gave an irritable twitch. You dislike the name Tom? There are a lot of Toms. Was my father a wizard? He was called Tom Riddle, too, they've told me. I'm afraid I don't know. My mother can't have been magic, or she wouldn't have died. So, what does he assume about death?
If you're not grown up, you can stop it.
It sounds like Harry believing that magic will fix everything.
Okay.
But death is all certainty.
Go ahead first.
So magic can overcome death.
Magic can overcome death.
But death is not a certainty.
But death is not a certainty. All of those are right. My mother can't have been magic, or she wouldn't have died. Okay? So when he adopts the name Lord Voldemort, what's he doing? Which is only 5 years after this. Okay? This whole desire to flee from death, it's not on a whim. It kind of comes almost from his birth. Okay? Dumbledore says, you'll get all the details about the school in that piece of parchment. So, they go back to Dumbledore's office. Dumbledore tells Harry, sit down. Harry's dumbfounded. He believed it much quicker than I did. I mean, when you told him he was a wizard, I didn't believe Hagrid at first when he told me. Okay, but what's your bit of the difference?
Harry didn't realize he was doing weird special things before then.
Okay.
He didn't think he was special.
He didn't think he was special.
Harry was raised, told that magic doesn't exist.
Harry was, yeah, essentially. Well, he wasn't told because nothing was said about magic.
Nothing like that.
Okay. But Tom Riddle probably...
Tom knows that his mom's magic.
He didn't until just now. Okay.
Tom was looking for a reason to embrace the the things he'd been feeling and experiencing.
What did Dumbledore do that kind of proved everything he said? He makes that dresser burst into flames and then puts it out. Does Hagrid do anything like that?
No.
And compare Dumbledore versus Hagrid. Snazzy dress, you know, if you're into plum velvet suits, versus a guy who carries cakes around in his pockets, you know. Okay, so Hagrid proves all this stuff about magic. Hagrid doesn't prove all this stuff about magic. Harry doesn't get that kind of proof. Tom Riddle does. Okay, he sees that there's real magic. Harry, when Hagrid still comes, okay, what happens the very next morning when Harry wakes up?
He thought it was a dream.
He doesn't think it's real until he sees Hagrid. He thinks it was a dream. Tom Riddle never really considers it to be a dream. But Riddle was perfectly ready to believe that he was, says Dumbledore. To use his word, special. Did you know then? Did I know I had just met the most dangerous dark wizard of all time? No. I had no idea that he was to grow up to be what he is. However, I was certainly intrigued by him. He says I was going to keep an eye on him very, very closely. Okay? And Dumbledore kind of says, okay, Harry, let's recap a little bit. His powers, as you heard, were surprisingly well developed for such a young wizard. He'd already discovered he had some measure of control over them, begun to use them consciously. Okay? He's already using magic against other people to frighten, to punish, to control. Harry, and he was a Parselmouth. Yes, indeed. A rare ability, once supposedly connected with the dark arts, although, as we know, there are Parselmouths among the great and the good, too. Where do we know that?
Harry.
He's the only one. Who are the only Parselmouths that we know who have existed? Slytherin, now, Marvolo and Morphin, Voldemort, Harry.
To be fair, Harry is the Horcrux for a dark wizard.
Does Harry have that talent and ability on his own? No, he doesn't. It's from Voldemort. It's from Voldemort putting a bit of himself into me. Okay? So, I hope you noticed Riddle's reaction when I mentioned his name, Tom. He showed his contempt for anything that tied him to other people, anything that made him ordinary. In other words, at the age of 11, he thought of himself as what? A Superman kind of a character. Not the one in tights and cape, but is somebody not bound by the same laws that ordinary people are bound by. Right? I trust you also noticed Tom Riddle was already highly self-sufficient, secretive, apparently friendless. Notice he didn't want any help on his trip to Diagon Alley. The adult Voldemort is the same. You'll hear many of his Death Eaters claiming that they are in his confidence, that they alone are close to him, even understand him. Didn't the book begin with that? Okay. Bellatrix and Snape. Going back and forth as to who's closer to Voldemort. Bellatrix in a weird kind of romantic sexual way, though nothing ever comes of that. She'd like it to. Snape in what? The kind of personal confidant way. You know, Bellatrix, it's not my fault that the Dark Lord doesn't share all of his plans with you. And just because I know them, I'm not going to share them with you.
Minion.
Yeah. They are deluded. Lord Voldemort has never had a friend, nor do I believe that he has ever wanted one. Why not? What do friends do? What do friends make you? They make you weak.
Vulnerable.
They make you vulnerable. Because what must you do to make friends? Imagine you're 10 years old. You're 11 years old. You're going to go off to a boarding school you've never been to, you've never seen. Only thing you've heard of is some funny-looking guy in a plum velvet suit has told you stories about. How are you when you arrive there, if you're a normal child?
Anxious.
Scared. Itless. Okay? Yeah. Nervous. Anxious. Tom Riddle? Confident. Cocky. Not wanting to start talking to the first person he meets. What does Harry do when he first gets on the Hogwarts Express? He and Ron head up there a friendship immediately. Okay? And it's a little awkward at first, but it grows. Not Tom Riddle. Lastly, I hope you're not too sleepy to pay attention to this, Harry. The young Tom Riddle liked to collect trophies. You saw the box of stolen articles? Harry says, yeah. Harry notices the table. The ring's gone. Very astute, Harry. Nothing more. Chapter 14, Felix Felicis. Yes?
Could the Horcruxes be his modern day trophies?
Yeah. Yeah, that's what they are. I mean, they are really nothing but trophies. And this is where Rowling gets, I think, really genius. Okay? In any other world, well, let's put it this way. In our world, what kind of person would be called Lord Voldemort?
Serial killer.
Serial killer. Okay? Sociopath. A sociopathic serial killer. What do serial killers often do?
Collect trophies.
Okay? Those trophies give them what?
A release?
No.
They relive it.
They relive it, and it gives them a sense of power over the person whom they have killed. And they'll collect, you know, you want to get all weird, you're going to do this if you're going to do this. You know, read about serial killers and stuff, and some of the things they collect are really weird.
Voice recording.
Fingers, ears, eyeballs, tongues, genitalia. I mean, pretty much everything under the sun.
Organs, blood samples.
Yeah, organs, blood samples. As long as it's connected to their victim. Okay? Not necessarily, you know, they go through the house and get their high school diploma. It's usually something directly, articles of clothing that they were wearing when they were killed, okay? Blood sample, tissue sample, whatever, okay?
Is it a coincidence that Slughorn is kind of the polar opposite and that he collects the people, the memories
collects
that he
people.
Affected?
Well, it's not just, though, that he collects the people that he affected. Because what is Slughorn doing?
Famous people. For people with some kind of power or some kind of pull or tag or some.
Keep going.
Velocity of the sin.
Okay. Why does Slughorn, you know, think of the Slug Club. Who are some of the members of the Slug Club? For example, Jenny's on there. Why? Because of her bat bogey hex. He saw her do that. He's like, I want that girl in my club. What about some of the other people, like McLagan?
He has a famous uncle.
In other words, it's all about
connections.
Okay. He wants to surround himself with either people who are very capable at a particular skill or people who can connect him to other people. Okay? So that's a bit different. Than Voldemort. Okay, so what does Voldemort do with his quote-unquote trophies? Rather than keeping them for the bit of the person that they represent, as a serial killer would do, he puts himself into them.
And then hides them.
Talk about taking control. It's really twisted. Okay.
I would love to know who Voldemort was based off of.
Oh, I don't think she ever says that. But I think it, you know, you think she starts writing, it's about 1990, 1991. I'd say go back through probably British publications, maybe Ted Bundy. But I'd say read about serial killers from maybe like 1960 through 1980 or 1985. Because, I mean, they pretty much, you create a composite. They all look a lot alike, okay? Ted Bundy, Jeffrey Dahmer.
I'd actually say that you could probably find more of Voldemort in classic British literature of serial killers. Jack the Ripper, Sweeney Todd,
yeah,
so on and so forth.
How about Dorian Gray, British literature?
Yeah, but he's not really a serial killer.
She's
crazy. Yeah, he's, well, yeah, you have your life put in a portrait, you'd be a little crazy too.
Yeah, like it has the Horcrux aspect.
Yeah, it does. Okay. Next chapter, Felix Felicis. Yeah, I think we can actually skip most of this. Except for Harry starting to have feelings for Ginny. It actually started earlier, but he wins a Quidditch match and hugs Ginny and then lets her go real quickly because it's like, you know, it's my best friend's sister. Go on to chapter 15, The Unbreakable Vow. Let's see here. Harry's gone to Slughorn's party. This is probably around page 320. 318 to 322, somewhere in there. And Slughorn and Trelawney are speaking. And Slughorn sees Harry. And he says, "My dear boy, the rumors, the stories, the chosen one. Of course, I've known for a very long time the omens were never good." This is Trelawney speaking. "The omens were never good, Harry, but why have you not returned to divination? First, you of all people, the subject is of the utmost importance." And then Slughorn intervenes and talks about how wonderful Harry is at potions. And then he says this, "Instinctive, you know, like his mother. I've only ever taught a few with this kind of ability. I can tell you that, Sybil. Why, even Severus." So notice, who does he mention? Lily and Severus. Okay, we know, later on, we know that Lily and Severus were close. Did she get to use the potions book that belonged to the Half-Blood Prince too?
Is it next to Severus Side, you mean?
I'm just throwing this out there. They were good friends. She was...
This would have been sixth year. Or fifth year.
Yeah. Sixth year. This one would have been sixth year. Oh, no, it couldn't have been because they wouldn't have been friends anymore. Because it happened at the end of the fifth year. Okay, so she has raw natural talent, he says. Instinctive. But then he starts to say, why even Severus?
Unless they just...
Why even Severus what? He doesn't finish his sentence. What's he starting to say?
Why even Severus wasn't this good.
Or, why even Severus wasn't as good as Lily. Okay? We're also told repeatedly, Lily was especially good at what? Charms. Charms. Okay? So, Harry, Slughorn goes on and talks about natural ability. Snape-like. Are we talking about the same Potter? "I never had the impression I managed to teach Potter anything at all," says Snape. First lesson, the draft of living death. Never had a student produce fine art a first attempt. I don't think even you, Severus. Whoa. Really? Says Snape. Slughorn asks Harry, what other subject are you taking? Harry says, and Snape says, all the subjects required in short for an auror. Yeah, that's what I'd like to be. Okay. So, Harry notices, next page, 321. Harry notices Snape looking kind of oddly at Malfoy. Filch's expression of outrage, disappointment was perfectly predictable. But why, Harry wondered, watching him, did Malfoy look almost equally unhappy? And why was Snape looking at Malfoy as though both angry and a little afraid? And then Harry kind of looks at Malfoy and notices this is the first time he'd seen Malfoy close up for ages. He now saw that Malfoy had dark shadows under his eyes and a distinctly grayish tinge to his skin. Snape tells Malfoy he'd like a word with him. Harry goes off and spies on them. Okay? He overhears this conversation. How does Malfoy address Snape? And how is it different from books 1-5? Who suspects me, says Malfoy angrily. For the last time, I didn't do it, okay? The bell girl must have had an enemy no one knows about. Don't look at me like that. I know what you're doing. I'm not stupid. It won't work. I can stop you. What's Draco talking about? I can do occlumency. You can't read my mind. Aunt Bellatrix has been teaching you occlumency, I see. What thoughts are you trying to conceal from your master, Draco? I'm not trying to conceal anything from him. I just don't want you butting in. Snape's been replaced. So is that why you've been avoiding me this term? You feared my interference? Put me in detention. Report me to Dumbledore. Snape, listen to me. I'm trying to help you. I swore to your mother I would protect you. I made the unbreakable vow, Draco. Looks like you'll have to break it then. Yeah, and die. Because I don't need your protection. It's my job. He gave it to me and I'm doing it. I've got a plan. It's going to work. What is your plan? None of your business. If you tell me what you're trying to do, I can assist you. Okay? Confide in me and I can... I know what you're up to. You want to steal my glory. Remember when Harry saw Chamber of Secrets? When Harry saw Draco and Lucius go into Borgin and Burks? And the first thing Draco saw, and he reached out for, the Hand of Glory. Okay? And Borgin said, oh, your son has good taste, you know. And Lucius says, yeah, if he's just going to be a common thief. Okay? Here, Draco's talking about glory. Chapter 16. A very frosty Christmas. Harry asks Ron and Fred and George, so what's the unbreakable vow? Ron, nah, it couldn't have been that. Are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. What does it mean? You can't break an unbreakable. Yeah, I worked that out for myself. What happens if you break it? You die. Fred and George tried to get me to make one when I was about 5. I nearly did, too. Really? Isn't that pretty advanced magic? I was holding hands with Fred and everything when Dad found us. He went mental. Only time I've ever seen Dad is angry as Mom. Fred reckons his left buttock has never been the same since. Okay. They keep talking, and let's go on to page 311. Let's see where I want to pick. Sorry, not 311. About 331 or so. There's a song quoted, four lines and then two lines. Okay. They're at the Weasley's house, I think it is. And you have the, oh my poor heart, where has it gone? It left me for a spell. And Mr. Weasley asks Harry, has it occurred to you, Harry, that Snape was simply pretending? Pretending to offer help so that he could find out what Malfoy's up to? Yeah, I thought you'd say that. And then Harry asks the question. But how do we know? This is, in philosophy, this is the branch called epistemology. How do you know what you know? One branch of epistemology says we know what we know through our senses. Okay? How do we know? Lupin. It isn't our business to know. What's Harry asking, how do we know about?
How do we know that Snape is actually on our side?
How do we know Snape is on our side? It isn't our business to know, says Lupin. It's Dumbledore's business. Dumbledore trusts Severus, and that ought to be good enough for all of us. Why? What connection or what step does he leave out?
When we trust Dumbledore.
We trust Dumbledore. What do they have in Dumbledore?
Implicit trust.
Implicit trust, or I heard the word, faith. Okay? We didn't talk about it, I don't think. At the end of Order of the Phoenix, you know, when Harry meets Luna, and Luna tells him her stuff goes missing every year at the end of the school year. Okay? And they start to talk about Sirius and Luna's mom and such. And Harry says, well, you want me to help go looking for it? And she goes, no, it'll come back on its own. Like her luggage, her things have a will and locomotion of their own. Okay? And that's when they then go on to talk about Luna's mother, Sirius. And she says, it's not like you'll never see him again. Harry's like, really? Luna thinks a lot of weird things. And she says, come on. You heard them, the voices behind the veil, just out of sight. And Harry's kind of wrestling with that. And then he asks again, are you sure you don't want me to help you? She goes, no, let's go down to the feast. It'll all be there when I come back. What's Luna showing? Faith. Faith. Faith in a God? No, not necessarily. Faith that everything will turn out how it ought to. Okay? Faith isn't knowledge. Faith isn't knowing. Okay? It's Dumbledore's business. Harry, yeah, but let's, you know, for sake of argument, let's say Dumbledore's wrong. People have said it many times. It comes down to whether or not you trust Dumbledore's judgment. I do. Therefore, I trust Severus. Okay? Notice, it comes down to whether or not you trust Dumbledore's judgment. What does that mean? Can Dumbledore make mistakes?
Yes, I have.
What did he tell Harry at the end of the previous book? I acted like we fools who love act. I cared more for your what?
Happiness.
Your happiness than for my plan. Okay? We fools who love often make mistakes. Judgment isn't an aspect of love, though, is it? Judgment's based on reason. Harry, but Dumbledore can make mistakes. He says it himself. And he looks Lupin straight in the eye. Do you honestly like Snape? Notice what confusion is in Harry's mind. Trust versus liking. I neither like nor dislike Snape, said Lupin. No, speaking the truth, we shall never be bosom friends. Perhaps after all that happened between James and Sirius and Severus, there is too much bitterness there. But I do not forget that during the year I taught at Hogwarts, Severus made the Wolfsbane potion for me every month, made it perfectly, so that I did not have to suffer as I usually do at the full moon. But he let slip accidentally that you were a werewolf. News would have leaked out anyway. After all, what did Lupin do that night? Went off werewolf crazy in the forest and stuff. Maybe he didn't dare mess with the potion with Dumbledore watching him. You are determined to hate him, Harry. Why? Because James is his father? No. No. Harry wasn't raised with that kind of prejudice in his house. With James as your father, Sirius as your godfather, you have inherited an old prejudice, Lupin says. How could he be inherited that prejudice from his father when he never knew his father? Okay, he sees the memory. Would that memory make him act more like his father? Or the opposite? By all means, tell Dumbledore what you've told Arthur and me, but do not expect him to share your view of the matter. Do not even expect him to be surprised by what you tell him. It might have been on Dumbledore's orders that Severus questioned Draco. What is Harry getting at with that question? How do we know? He's asking, how can you be sure Dumbledore is right? What does he want? Proof. How often do we really get in this life proof? Someone says, I love you. Where's the proof? I don't have mine on because my fingers are swollen. It's not a ring. That's not proof. Where's the proof? Actions. Proof isn't words. Proof isn't gifts. I'll give you proof. It's when my mom died in January, after being married to my dad for 61 and a half years. That's proof. That's what? Did they like each other every day? Nope. Did they get angry with each other? Yep. But they didn't leave. They always stayed. That's what Harry's seeking. He's seeking that kind of proof. Does he ever get it? All of Book 7. Until almost the end, is all about one thing. Belief. We're going to hear Harry say repeatedly, do they really think it's that easy to tell me just to believe when I need to know? Belief versus knowing. He's going to have people tell him, Harry, you knew Dumbledore. Believe him. But he's going to read Rita Skeeter and hear what others say. And he wants to know the truth. The truth? What's Dumbledore say? It's a beautiful and terrible thing. Where does Harry ultimately get the truth? It's when he's dead. Mm-hmm. It's when he, not mostly dead. Not nearly dead. He's dead in that chapter, King's Cross in Book 7. Okay? So, did he get the answer he wanted? No. Notice we are not quite two-thirds of the way through. And what is Harry starting to show?
Doubt.
Doubt. Which is the opposite of belief. Okay? That passage that I talked about, the end of Order of the Phoenix, with Harry and Luna. When Harry met Luna, if you remember it, how was he feeling? Anybody remember? Who had he just spoken to? Nearly Headless Nick. Why'd he talk to Nick?
Death.
You're dead? What's it like? I can't really tell you. What do you mean you can't tell me? You're dead. He said, yes, kind of. He said, but I never went on. What do you mean you never went on? Because Harry wants to know if Sirius is going to come back as a ghost. And he says, no, he will have gone on. Gone on where? Can't tell you. Never been there. I chose my poor, pale imitation of life. Okay? Harry leaves Nick feeling worse. He feels like Sirius has died all over again, and he is empty. He meets Luna. They talk. Luna says, it's not like you'll ever meet him again. You heard those voices. Come on, just beyond the veil, just lurking out of sight. And he leaves Luna feeling what? Suddenly full of joy and light and love and got the glory of Jesus? No. But he does leave feeling what? Less empty. Is he full of faith? Nope. But he has less doubt. So he has a little bit of faith and a lot of doubt. Okay? That doubt is starting to grow. What kind of answers is Dumbledore giving him in these lessons? Voldemort History 101. How I Became a Rotten Person. So, they start talking about the Half-Blood Prince. Lupin says, there is no royalty. There are no wizarding princes. Harry mentions the Levicorpus spell. Lupin, oh, I remember that one. There was a great vogue of that during my time at Hogwarts. Maybe indicating when the Half-Blood Prince was there. Harry, my dad used it. I saw him in the Pensieve. He used it on Snape. Yeah, but he wasn't the only one, Lupin says. It was very popular. Harry, sounds like it was invented while you were at school. Lupin, not necessarily. So you're sure Dad wasn't the Half-Blood Prince? That's what Harry's thinking. No. Okay? Let's go on a bit. Rufus Scrimgeour comes. Okay? He wants to talk to Harry. And he says, I thought I had a page number written down here. Probably around 344 or so. I'm not skipping at the beginning of the conversation. I'm not beginning at the beginning of it. Scrimgeour says, the rumors, all these whispers of a prophecy, of you being the chosen one. Harry's thinking, we're almost on the target. He's getting to what he wants from me. I've seen Dumbledore has discussed these matters with you. Harry, yeah, we've discussed it. Have you? Okay. And what has Dumbledore told you, Harry? Sorry, it's between us. It's a question of confidence, as Scrimgeour says. I wouldn't want you to divulge. No, no. In any case, doesn't really matter, does it, whether you are the chosen one or not? I don't really know what you mean, Minister. Golly gee, I'm just a dumb old hick. Harry kind of plays. Well, of course, to you it will matter enormously. Okay, so what has he just done? Doesn't matter to me whether you're the chosen one. Why? Because I don't have to fight Voldemort. It'll matter to you, of course. But to the wizarding community at large, well, it's all perception, isn't it? It's what people believe that's important. What does he mean? Is he talking about this kind of belief? Is he talking about faith kind of belief? What does he mean by perception and what people believe? Have any of you kept track or saw the news yesterday about the Panama Law Office thing? What's the perception?
Documents. Yeah.
Like 11.5 million documents that have been published online that show what?
Corruption.
What kind of corruption? Is it real corruption?
The world's leader is hiding away money.
The world's leaders doing what? Putting their money in tax shelters in the Caribbean. Okay? The Prime Minister of Iceland resigned over it. He resigned today. He was outed yesterday or Sunday. Okay? Putin has people very close to him involved. David Cameron's father was involved. Okay? Are they saying that all of these people are criminals? No, they are not. What it's saying is that all these people used, some may have broken, the laws of their respective countries so that they didn't have to pay taxes in their countries. Okay? From a normal point of view, that's what?
Taxes.
It's corruption.
No. That's my point, though. Is it tax evasion if they're using the loopholes of the laws as written? No, that's smart. That's smart. To use the laws as written. It's tax evasion if you don't pay the taxes that are owed and you don't have loopholes that you can use to get out. If I didn't pay my taxes, okay, I would not get the same kind of treatment Tim Geithner got. Former Secretary of the Treasury, who owed six figures to the government. And he said it was I can never remember this. The online tax software you can use.
TurboTax?
Yeah. It was a TurboTax error. And he got confirmed by the Senate to be Secretary of the Treasury. The guy who's in charge of the people who come after you and get you if you don't pay your taxes. Okay?
I don't know what's the greater crime here. Him being him not having the right taxes in or him using TurboTax?
It's perception. It's what people believe that's important. So what do the people around the world in these respective countries now believe about their leaders? They're not following the rules. Or they're using the laws in a way that the laws aren't intended. That's the whole thing about the spirit and letter of the law. Notice, Harry said nothing. He saw dimly where Scrimgeour is going. Where is Scrimgeour going? It's what people believe. That's important. When Bill Clinton was being impeached in 1998, anybody remember what he did? Most of you are probably too young. He launched a missile attack in the Sudan. Why?
Distraction.
Going after Osama bin Laden. Turned out to be an aspirin factory. It was an actual aspirin factory. It wasn't chemical weapons of any sort. It was a distraction. Why? Perception. I was listening to talk radio today, and I don't remember who it was. One of the people said this. Every time Donald Trump loses a primary, what does he do? He shifts attention. Whose attention? Everybody's. What does he do? He comes out and says some wild, crazy thing, or he gets a new endorsement. Okay. Today, he's supposed to lose Wisconsin. What did he do? He explained how he's going to get Mexico to pay for that wall. Okay. Why? It's a diversionary tactic. It draws attention away from the thing really important. So, it's what people believe that's important. People believe you are the chosen one. All right? You see? They think you quite the hero. Notice what that means. They think you quite the hero. What does Scrimgeour think?
Not so much.
Not so much. Which, of course, you are, Harry. Chosen or not. How many times have you faced? You must not be named. Why doesn't he call him by his name?
Habit.
Well, anyway, the point is, you are a symbol of hope for many, Harry. What does he mean by symbol? He uses the modern meaning. 1,000 years ago, a symbol meant something else. Okay? What does he mean by symbol? You are a sign of hope. Okay? What did Dobby call Harry in book two? Harry's lying there in his hospital bed. Dobby wakes him up, sitting on his chest. And Dobby says, you were a beacon of light, a ray of hope to us downtrodden, dispossessed, we dregs of the magical world. He doesn't say you were a symbol of light. He says you were light. He doesn't say you were a symbol of hope. He says you were hope. Okay? Scrimgeour says you are a symbol of hope. That is, you are something that stand in for or represent something else. That's what we mean by the modern meaning of the word symbol. The original meaning of the word symbol is that you have something over here, you have something over here, you draw them together, and they become something else. Still retaining this and this. Okay? The idea there is somebody out there who might be able, who might even be destined to destroy he who must not be named. Well, I mean, it gives people a lift. Notice his two qualifications. Might. What's he saying?
It doesn't have to be so. It just has to be perceived as.
Where is he going? Well, Harry, you know, if you could be seen, you know. Snap! Having your picture taken going in and out of the Ministry of Magic. If you could be seen with some of our aurors, if we could get your picture on a billboard.
People would think that we're taking care of the problem. That Voldemort, that we stand a chance of defeating Voldemort, that you are doing your chosen duties.
How different is this from the Great War on Terror, etc.? What are the symbols we see now or hear? There was a drone attack. I mean, it's talked about today with nonchalance. Like there's nothing wrong with this. That we, the United States of America, uses drones to single out individuals and kill them. Without what?
Due process. Or impunity.
Simply because they are enemy combatants? How do we know they're enemy combatants?
This is a war on terror.
Because the government tells us so. And because the New York Times told us that President Obama personally signs off on every target done by a drone attack. Huh. Well, I can't help but feel that. Once you realize this, you might consider it, well, almost a duty to stand alongside the ministry. Okay? And give everyone a boost. If you're into Marvel Comics or Marvel Comic movies, this is what? This is Captain America in his silly little off-Broadway dance costume saying, buy American bonds and fight with Cap. Rather than doing a damn bit of good. I don't exactly understand what you mean, Harry says. Stand alongside the ministry. What does that mean? So, Harry interprets, you'd like to give the impression I'm working for the ministry. It would give everyone a lift to think you were more involved, Harry. More involved in what? Than now? Okay. The chosen one, you know, I mean, it's all about giving people hope. The feeling that exciting things are happening. What kind of hope?
Somebody's fighting to protect you.
Okay. Still, what kind of hope?
False hope?
Yes. Because what is the ministry really doing?
Just to scare everybody else.
Here's what they're doing. Here's what they're doing. Will and won't. About 4 pages in. A purple leaflet emblazoned with the words, issued on behalf of the Ministry of Magic, protecting your home and family against dark forces. How many of you remember the federal government, the United States federal government, giving us some advice after 9/11? They actually suggested stockpiling duct tape in plastic, clear plastic or black plastic, doesn't matter. So that you could use it for what purpose?
Tape up your windows.
Seal up your windows in case
a
chemical or biological weapon. Really? Point 1 mil thick plastic and duct tape. That's like when I was a kid growing up. In the 1960s, less than 20 miles away from Moffett Airfield in California, where the U-2s took off and landed. Gary Powers North, U-2 pilot shot down over Russia, and being told, you know, if you hear those air raid sirens, which is what they were still called then, go off, duck and cover, get down under your desk, in a kneeling position, put your hands over your head, curl into a little ball, and hope to God that the nuclear blast doesn't kill you. Like, that's going to help a lot. Yeah, they weren't, but they weren't commercials for us growing up in the 60s. I mean, it was once a month we did these things. Okay? And again, 20 miles from Moffett Airfield, about 25 miles from NASA Ames Research Center, okay? Plus, we had the burgeoning computer industry starting. So, I mean, we were big old bullseye on the Silicon Valley. Okay? We knew it would be hit very quickly. And yet, we did these things, okay? Harry's thinking, but if I keep running in and out of the ministry, won't that seem as though I approve what the ministry is up to? We'd like to. No. I don't like some of the things the ministry is doing. Like locking up Stan Shumpike. I would not expect you to understand. Why?
Because you're okay.
Because you're too young. These are dangerous times and you are 16 years old. And what should Harry say at that moment?
Well, I guess I'm not old enough to be.
Yeah, I fought Voldemort how many times compared to you? Sorry. Yeah, I said the word, Voldemort, 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 who, you know, give him the willies. Dumbledore's a lot older than 16. He doesn't think Stan should be an Azkaban either. You're making Stan a scapegoat, just like you want to make me a mascot. I see you prefer, like your hero Dumbledore, to disassociate yourself from the ministry. I don't want to be used, says Harry. Some would say it's your duty to be used by the ministry. Whoa! Why? Because you have a duty to your government. Harry, yeah, and others might say it's your duty to check people really are Death Eaters before you chuck them in prison. You're doing what Barty Crouch did. They're doing what else happened? What happened to Morphin? We're going to find out a little later. He got sent to Azkaban for what? A crime he didn't do. He got sent to Azkaban for something Voldemort did. Planted the memory in his mind. Either we've got Fudge pretending everything's lovely while people get murdered right under his nose, or we've got you chucking the wrong people into jail. And I could be completely wrong about this. But I kind of wonder if J.K. Rowling is making a political statement there, an applicability. Either we've got Bill Clinton pretending nothing's wrong, throughout the 1990s. Or we've got George Bush starting wars left and right. So you're not the chosen one? I thought you said it didn't matter. I shouldn't have said that. Tactless. No. It was honest. He is, after all, what? A politician. One of the only honest things you've said to me. You don't care whether I live or die, but you do care that I help you convince everyone you're winning the war against Voldemort. Does Dumbledore care whether he lives or dies? Yes, he does. I haven't forgotten, and he raises his right fist. With the scar, I shall not tell lies, or I must not tell lies. Notice, is his hand normally covered up? Does he wear a glove? You know, is he Darth Vader in training? No. So everybody can see that. I don't remember you rushing to my defense when I was trying to tell everyone Voldemort was back. Ministry wasn't so keen to be pals last year. What's Dumbledore up to? No idea. Wouldn't tell me if you knew, would you? Nope. Oh, okay, it's clear to me. You're Dumbledore's man through and through, aren't you, Potter? Yep. Glad we straightened that out. Dumbledore's man through and through. Notice this comes pretty hard on after we have to trust Dumbledore. If we can't trust Dumbledore, who can we trust? Okay. So, what makes Harry say I'm Dumbledore's man through and through? When he gets pushed kind of the other direction. A sluggish memory. They start having apparition lessons. And Harry has another lesson with Dumbledore. Around page 361. Harry and Dumbledore are talking. And Harry says, you didn't really trust him, did you, sir? Talking about Voldemort. Let us just say, I did not take it for granted that he was trustworthy. I resolved to keep a close eye on him. So, as he moved up into school, he gathered about him a group of dedicated friends. He says, I call them that, for lack of a better term. That's what they considered themselves. Who later became Death Eaters. Okay. Dumbledore says, I've not been able to find many memories of Riddle at Hogwarts, placing his withered hand on the pensive. Few who knew him then are prepared to talk about him. They are too terrified. Those whom I could persuade to talk told me that Riddle was obsessed with his parentage. It's understandable. All he had to go on was his grandfather's name, Marvolo. He didn't know the last part. All right. So he says, I do have this memory, which I was lucky to get. And they go into the pensive. Okay. And we see young Tom Riddle show up at the shack. And the person at the shack says, you! Because who does young Tom Riddle look like? Spitting image of dad. Okay. Riddle speaks in parcel tongues, so does Morfin. Where's Marvolo? Dead. Died years ago. Who are you then? Morfin, ain't I? Marvolo's son? Of course I am. So they start to talk. And what do we see? They come back out of the memory, and Dumbledore explains what all happened. Voldemort stole Morfin's wand and used it. Harry, Dumbledore, that's right. We don't have any memories to show us this, but I think it's fairly sure what happened. And what did Voldemort do? He used Morfin's wand to do what? He killed his parents with it. Excuse me, his grandparents and great-grandparents. He killed his father, okay, Tom Riddle Sr., and his grandparents, sorry. Dumbledore says, the next page, I extracted this memory with difficulty. When I saw what it contained, I attempted to use it to secure Morfin's release from Azkaban. But Before the Ministry reached their decision, however, Morphin died. Why did Dumbledore try to get Morphin out of Azkaban?
More memories.
For more memories, is that it? He just wanted to use Morphin?
Innocence.
Keep him on ice and until he could, you know, pump him full of Veritaserum? Say that again?
Innocent.
He was innocent. Is he nice?
No.
Is he totally innocent?
No.
Is he like the, you know, wind-driven snow? No. He's like the wind-driven snow that 50,000 trucks have driven over. Okay? But he shouldn't have been in Azkaban for murder. Because he never did it. How come the Ministry didn't realize that Voldemort had done all that to Morphin? I mean, he was underage at the time, wasn't he? I thought they could detect underage magic. You're quite right. They can detect magic, but not the perpetrator. They will certainly be unable to tell who performed the magic. They rely on witch and wizard parents to enforce their offspring's obedience while within their walls. Harry, well, that's rubbish. Look what happened here. Look what happened to Morphin. I agree. Whatever Morphin was, he did not deserve to die as he did. Blamed for murders he had not committed. Okay? So, Dumbledore says one more, pours another phial into the pensive, and he sees a much younger Horace Slughorn. And we see young Tom Riddle come ask Horace Slughorn about Horcruxes, and then the memory kind of goes wonky. Goes weird. Dumbledore says, the memory's been modified. I need you to get the real one, Harry. We can't really do much else, much more, until you get the real one. Okay? So, skip a bit. Ron's birthday comes on the 1st of March. Roughly around 388 or so. And Harry throws a birthday present to him. Okay. Ron says, cheer, pulls off the paper. And starts to eat from the box of chocolate cauldrons that has been delivered, or that he thought Harry threw to him. Okay. He eats one, and then two, and then he eats a third. Harry asks, you want to go down for breakfast? Ron's not hungry because he's just eaten three chocolate cauldrons. And what do we find out? Ron's madly in love with Romilda Vane, who has made the chocolate cauldrons, put the love potion into them for Ron? For Harry. Okay. They go to Slughorn's office. Slughorn gives them some wine to drink that he got from somebody meant to give to Dumbledore. Ron takes a sip. So he's been poisoned by love potion. Now he's poisoned by real poison. Nearly dies until Harry remembers the Bazaar. How does Harry remember that?
The book. Just does a Bazaar down his throat.
Very first question Snape asked him in Potions in the first book. Potter! Or maybe it's the third question. What is a Bazaar and what is it used for? Hermione knows. And Hermione answers the question. Okay. Elf Tales, there's a lot we can skip. Let's see here. Pick up with chapter 20, Lord Voldemort's request. Around around page 426, 428, somewhere around there. What page is that? Dumbledore is talking with Harry again. Okay. Harry says, I asked Professor Slughorn about it at the end of potions, that is, about the memory. I see. You feel that you've exerted your very best efforts in this matter? Do you? You've exercised all your considerable ingenuity? Harry was like, well, you know, Dumbledore, did that work? No, Ron got poisoned. Naturally made you forget all about trying to retrieve the memory. He says, I would have expected nothing else. You know, Ron's important, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So, Dumbledore says, from here on out, Harry, until we get the memory, things get a lot murkier. He says, now things become murkier and stranger. If it was difficult to find evidence about the boy riddle, it has been almost impossible to find anyone prepared to reminisce about the man Voldemort. In fact, I doubt whether there is a soul alive, apart from himself, who could give us a full account of his life since he left Hogwarts. However, I have two last memories that I would like to share with you. Okay? And he shows, or tells Harry, that Tom Riddle went to work at Borgin and Burke's. Harry's kind of struggling with that, and he says, I hope you'll understand why. Okay? And Dumbledore says, when Harry asks, why did Voldemort want to come here? That is, why did he want to come back to the school? I believe he had several reasons. First, he was more attached to the school than he's ever been to a person. Notice what he says. Hogwarts was where he had been happiest, the first and only place he had felt at home. What does that mean, to feel at home? What is home?
Refuge.
What else?
Comfort.
Comfort?
Where you can be yourself.
Yes. It's where you can be yourself. Supposedly, it's where you are accepted no matter what. Okay? And notice, Hogwarts was where he had been happiest. Had Tom Riddle ever been happy anywhere else? What kind of upbringing did Tom Riddle have? Pretty miserable. Harry felt slightly uncomfortable at these words, for this was exactly how he felt about Hogwarts too. When Harry goes off into the Forbidden Forest in Book 7, it's kind of interesting because he thinks about the Lost Boys, as he calls them. Tom Riddle, Severus Snape, and himself. Okay? Half-bloods. All of them. Two of them raised by people who were not their parents. And even Snape, are we told that his father leaves his mother? I want to say he does. Okay, so that Snape eventually is raised only by his mother. Okay? Secondly, the castle is a stronghold of ancient magic. Undoubtedly, Voldemort had penetrated many more of its secrets than most of the students do. Third, as a teacher, he'd have great power and influence over young witches and wizards. But he didn't get the job? No, he did not. Harry, and how did you feel about that, sir? Deeply uneasy. That is, when he, Dippet told him, you know, reapply years later. Deeply uneasy. I had advised Armando against the appointment. Didn't give any reasons. What job did he want? Defense against the Dark Arts. So Voldemort went off to Borgin and Burke's. Okay? And he was gifted at their place. So Dumbledore takes him into a memory. And what do we see happen? We see dashing young Tom Riddle. Do what? Con Hepzibah Burke, Hepzibah Hufflepuff, out of her belongings. Hepzibah Smith, sorry. Okay? What did he get from her? Cup. And the locket. Hoki gets convicted of the crime of accidentally poisoning her. And we pick up with Dumbledore telling Harry, trying to find a page number, 447. Somewhere around 440, 441. Harry says, but wasn't he mad? Wasn't he risking everything, throwing away his job just for those? He doesn't finish the thought. He says, I hope you'll understand, Dumbledore, I hope you'll understand in due course what those objects mean to him. But you must admit, it's not difficult to imagine that he saw the locket, at least it's rightfully his. Harry, well, yeah, the locket, I can understand. But why take the cup? It had belonged to another of Hogwarts' founders. I think he still felt a great pull towards the school. He could not resist an object so steeped in Hogwarts' history. In other words, the cup is like a relic. It was something that had touched Helga Hufflepuff. Okay? So he says, now, one more memory. They pop in. There's Dumbledore in his office. And in comes Tom Riddle. But not the dashing young Tom Riddle. His features were not those Harry had seen emerge from the Great Stone Cauldron almost 2 years before. They were not as snake-like. Great Stone Cauldron 2 years before. Oh, okay. I was thinking Chamber of Secrets for some reason. They were not as snake-like. The eyes were not yet scarlet. The face not yet mask-like. And yet he was no longer handsome Tom Riddle. It was as though his features had been burned and blurred. They were waxy and oddly distorted, and the whites of the eyes now had a permanently bloody look, though the pupils were not yet the slits that Harry knew they would become. Why does he look this way?
He's beginning to regress.
He's already started it. Okay? What happens when you create a Horcrux? You rip your soul. Okay? This is the clearest depiction of that spiritual, physical thing I was talking about. He's torn his spirit. His body's torn as well. He's becoming inhuman. Good evening, Tom. Won't you sit down? Thank you. I heard that you had become headmaster. A worthy choice. Glad you approve. May I offer you a drink? That would be welcome. I've come a long way. How long has he come? Where has he come from? Dumbledore is going to say, my spies tell me that you've been in Albania. Albania to Scotland's pretty long distance. Okay. Dumbledore, go get a bottle of something. So, Tom, to what do I owe the pleasure? Sips his wine. They do not call me Tom anymore. These days I am known as, I know what you are known as. But to me, I'm afraid you will always be Tom Riddle. Does that sound like anything else we've seen earlier in the books?
Order of the Phoenix, when they're fighting.
To me, you'll always be Ickle Didikins, Harry says to Dudley. What is Dumbledore doing?
Remaining dominant.
Remaining dominant. He's setting the terms of the debate. To me, you're always Tom Riddle. What does that mean? 11 to 16 or 17? And I'm always headmaster. Master, pupil. Don't forget.
He also did that with the ministry when they were in his office. Even though.
Yeah, he calls him Tom there too. Okay?
And Horace, the Minister of Magic.
Fudge, yeah. It is one of the irritating things about old teachers, I'm afraid. They never quite forget their charge's youthful beginnings. So he's reminding him there. Because when is this? When does Tom Riddle come at this point to ask for the Defense Against the Dark Arts job?
About 20 years or so after graduating.
Is this the first year that it's open? In the 15, 16 years since it's been open every year? I'm not told. I think the implication is it's when he doesn't get it that the job starts being cursed. Okay? He raised his glass as though toasting Voldemort, whose face remained expressionless. Nevertheless, Harry felt the atmosphere in the room change subtly. Dumbledore's refusal to use Voldemort's chosen name was a refusal to allow Voldemort to dictate the terms of the meeting. And Harry could tell that Voldemort took it as such. I always wondered why wizards such as yourself never wished to leave school. Well, says Dumbledore, to a wizard such as myself, there can be nothing more important than passing on ancient skills, helping hone young minds. You once saw the attraction of teaching, too. I see it still. I merely wondered why you, who is so often asked for advice by the ministry, who has twice, I think, been offered the post of minister, three times, last count. Okay. But the ministry never attracted me as a career. Something we have in common, I think. Is that true? Even in, with what we learn in Book 7, did Dumbledore ever want to be Minister of Magic? No. He ran into a rule in the world with Gellert Grindelwald. Forget the Minister of Magic stuff. That's for peons. Okay? I have returned, later perhaps than Professor Dippet expected, but I have returned nevertheless to request again what he once told me I was too young to have. I've come to ask you, to you to ask that you permit me to return to this castle to teach. I think you must know that I have seen and done much since I left this place. I certainly do know you have seen and done much since leaving us. Rumors of your doings have reached your old school, Tom. I should be very sorry to believe half of them. Seen and done much? Wow. Greatness inspires envy. Envy engenders spite. Spite spawns lies. You must know this, Dumbledore. What's he saying? Your greatness must have inspired envy. That envy engenders spite. That spite spawns lies. Beginning of Book 5? And everything Fudge is saying about Dumbledore? Dumbledore, you call it greatness what you've been doing, do you? Certainly. I have pushed the boundaries of magic further, perhaps, than they have ever been pushed. Of some kinds of magic. Of some. What does he mean, I've pushed the boundaries of magic? And I don't mean just immortality kind of thing. Put that in a real-world perspective. What's he saying? I just saw an article about this yesterday. Scientists have come up with the wonderful idea of bringing back to life the Aurochs, a kind of a cross between a buffalo and a bull type creature that died out around 12,000 BC, that stood about 7 or 8 feet tall at the shoulder, if I remember correctly, and had horns like 10 feet wide.
Isn't it like a proto-cow?
Yeah, it's kind of like a proto-cow. Big old massive thing. They were native in Great Britain. Okay? They figure prominently in the caves of Lascaux, France. Okay? The primitive paintings on the walls. They want to bring them back. Okay? Jurassic Park, anybody?
As awesome as it would seem to ride this massively horned cow thing, and I don't think that's a very good idea.
Yeah, I don't think they want to bring it back to ride, but anyways.
When you bring that up, is it kind of like the phrase of you spent so much time thinking that you could, you never stopped to ask that you should?
Yeah, it's exactly it. You know? We never stop to think. Scientists seldom stop to think, should I? Not could I. You know, when Oppenheimer, when they detonated the first atomic bomb, J. Robert Oppenheimer said, I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. And he was like, can't do it. Can't put the genie back in the bottle. Obama can have as many nuclear summits as he wants, and he can talk about ridding the world of nuclear weapons. It'll never happen. Why not? Because of these things. You can download the plans to build one. Then it's just merely a matter of getting the material. Okay? Of some kinds of magic, Voldemort smiles. The old argument. Notice, what does that mean? Or what does that imply?
That some magics aren't relevant.
No.
That this argument has been had before.
They've had this discussion before. The old argument. But nothing I've seen in the world has supported your famous pronouncements that love is more powerful than my kind of magic. Notice, it's not like he can't say the word. What has he just said? Nothing I have seen in the world has supported your famous pronouncements that love is more powerful than my kind of magic. What has Tom Riddle seen in the world?
Not love.
Dead. What did he see at the orphanage? Drunkenness, possible abuse. Love?
Nope.
No. What did he see from his mother? Abandonment. Okay. What did he see from Dumbledore?
Suspicion.
Gotcha. Okay. But what else? He gave him a place at the school. That's love. That's an expression of love. Where did he look for it? Out there. Dumbledore, perhaps you've been looking in the wrong places. What does he mean? Where should Tom Riddle be looking for love? You know, there's that old, what is it, Elvin Bishop's song? Looking for love in all the wrong places, looking for love in all the wrong spaces, something like that. Well, then what better place to start my fresh researches than here at Hogwarts. Notice, how does he talk about love?
A subject to be researched.
An object should be studied rather than
experienced,
something to be experienced, felt. Both of those are passive.
Given.
Love is an action. It's not merely an emotion. Okay? It's a giving of self. Will you let me return? Will you let me share my knowledge with your students? I place myself and my talents at your disposal. I am yours to command. You know, kind of takes a knee, so to speak. Dumbledore. And what will become of those whom you command? Your Death Eaters. Oh, my friends. Glad to hear that you consider them friends. I was under the impression they are more in the order of servants. You are mistaken, says Voldemort. So if I go to the Hogshead tonight, I won't find not Rosier, Mulciple, Dorlhoff awaiting your return. Defloating friends, I'm sure. You are omniscient as ever, Dumbledore. What's happened to this conversation? Getting a little frosty in here. No, merely friendly with the local barman. Well, who is the local barman, not barmen, at Hogshead?
His brother.
It's his brother who likes to do unnatural things with goats. Let us speak openly. Why have you come here tonight, surrounded by henchmen, to request a job we both know you do not want? A job I do not want, on the contrary. I want it very much. Well, you want to come back to Hogwarts, but you don't want to teach. Any more than you wanted to when you were 18. What is it you're after, Tom? Why not try an open request for once? In other words, be honest. Once. Be honest. This question is almost the exact same question Harry asks him at the end of Book 7. With just a slight change in wording. Harry asks him, why not try for some remorse for once? If you do not want to give me, of course I don't. I don't think for a moment you expected me to. But you came here, you asked, you must have had a purpose. This is your final word, it is. Then we have nothing more to say to each other. In other words, the hackles are up. let's get ready to, you know, mano a mano. No, nothing. Time is long gone when I could frighten you with a burning wardrobe and force you to make repayment for your crimes. But I wish I could, Tom. I wish I could. Does he mean he's not able to? No, it's not what Dumbledore means. He means it wouldn't work. He means you are now, what? Fully an adult. You are, you know, your own agent, so to speak. And Harry says, why'd he come back? Did you ever find out? Have ideas. And I shall tell you, Harry, when you have retrieved that memory from Professor Slughorn. We'll stop there for tonight.
And that revolves around the four house artifacts that Thor most likely has.
Yep.